Hey guys, so I'm going to do a how-to-ish video of sorts, one that I said I was going to do a little while ago. I think it was late last year I said I was going to do something like this. It's, I guess, more of a demo how-to, how I do it, I guess, than a how-to. On the newer things that I do as I'm weathering my models. So basically it's going to take it from just after base painting all the way up to the final stages of weathering to completion. So my test monkeys, these guys here, are going to be what I'm going to use. I'm going to do two different types of weathering. Two of these vehicles are for a winter scene, and the other vehicle is for a spring-summer scene. The Easy 8 is for the spring and summer, and these two are for a winterish scene. Or it's the other way around. Oh, shit, I don't remember. No, it's the Easy 8's the winter one. These guys are for the spring scene. Mostly because of availability of figures. Anyway, that's another story. So the idea is to demonstrate the newer techniques that I'm using, which I haven't really demonstrated or talked about in any of my videos, really. And I haven't done a how-to video on any of them, so I haven't really explained much of what it is I've been doing lately on them. And there's a reason for that. Mostly it's because I've been trying to get them right. I've been working on them and developing them and practicing them and so on and so forth. So until I know how to do them, there's no point in doing a how-to video or a demonstration or a show-and-tell or anything, because I don't know what I'm doing. But I'm reasonably confident now that I figured it out that I can show what it is I'm doing. So, these three vehicles right now are in their base colors, and I just finished putting the decals on and sealing the decals in. I haven't done any detail painting or chipping or anything else to them at all. So, in order for me to progress, I have to do the detail painting, and then the video series will start from there. So it doesn't include any detail painting or anything like that. So it'll basically be starting from a gloss surface. So these three vehicles have all been painted in, the Shermans have been painted in the same color, and the Pershing has been painted in a slightly different color. Mostly on the mindset that these two vehicles came roughly from the same sort of factory, and this one came from a different one, and would have received slightly different paint mixes, because the ages of vehicles and paint stock supplies and stuff like that, the paint tended to vary a bit. And I've seen pictures of Pershing sitting next to Sherman's, and they had a slightly different color anyway. So I'm not really stuck on the exactness of colors. I'll explain this right now before I go any further. I really don't get my knickers in a twist on how exact this shade of Dunkelgelb is, or how exact this shade of Olive Grun or Olive Drab or whatever, and who makes it. I really don't give a crap, because in the end it doesn't make any difference who makes it or how exact it is, because once you finish weathering it, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how exact it is, because you can't tell. So, you know, it's good to get close, so, and they all kind of get close. A couple kind of go way off, you know, here and there, but most of them get it close enough that it doesn't really make any difference. So it's whatever paint you like painting with, because it's consistency is fun for you. But when it comes to shades, you know, you're kind of wasting your time, I think, trying to get the perfect shade of yellow and the perfect shade of blue or whatever the frig other, because once you're done weathering, this doesn't apply for the aircraft, really. Aircraft is a bit more exacting. It does apply a little, but not completely, right? Once you're done your weathering, there's going to be an enormous change in the shade and the tone, right? And you cannot always control it. You could be the best modeler in the world, and you're going to have a wide degree of variance. It's just, we're not scientists. And even if we were, we're still going to have variety. And you could do the same thing 15 times in a row. It doesn't mean you're going to get the same result, right? You're not working in absolute scientific controlled situations in a man cave or on your coffee table. So you're not going to always get the same shade right every time. It's not going to work. So you could try, you know, but my mind tends to go towards, don't try to be perfect, just try to be better. And don't worry about trying to be perfect. So if you're trying to get the same shade every single time, you're just pissing into the wind. So that's my opinion on trying to get the exact shade of green or the exact shade of yellow. If you want to try and do that, go right ahead. But don't be bothering me with your ideas on it, because I think you're crazy. And all honestly, I think you're a nut trying to do that. It's a waste of your time. So anyway, now when it comes to using decals and glosses for varnishes and stuff like that, I'm going to set that straight now on what I do. I don't give a crap what other people's opinions are on this. There are some variety in opinions on this, and I think a lot of them are lunacy. I always use gloss, high quality gloss. In my case, I use Alclad's Aqua Gloss to seep my decals, because it takes the rough edges out of the paint surface that the decals get to sit on, and it makes it easier to get the bubbles out and reduces silvering. And I know it does that, because when I don't use it, silvering happens. When I do it, silvering doesn't happen. Simply put, there you go. That's all there is to it, right? There's no scientific method needed. It's just repetition of application causes the same effect. So I just keep doing it because I know it works. When I don't do it, it fails. When I do it, it doesn't. So there you go. That's the end of the argument on that. So I have put the gloss on and seated the decals on here. And I just recently sealed all the decals on these vehicles. So they're all ready for the next phase, which will be detail painting the entire vehicles, which is like painting the tools and the stowage. And then what I usually do is, after all the tools and the stowage are painted, the vehicle's going to look like it's brand new. Then I seal the whole thing in gloss paint, and then I do chipping. But I'll explain that once I get to that point. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to do the detail painting, and then when I come back, we'll go on to the next phase. All right, guys. So my three tanks are now gloss painted and sealed and detail painted, and all that good clean stuff. There's nothing else that I would do to them to get them ready for the next stage. They look like shiny, brand new tanks, actually. Very boring, in all honesty. This will be kind of an interesting thing, because two of them don't have tracks on them, and one of them does, which means that I'll be weathering them slightly differently. So there'll be a mix of how things are done on this. Like I mentioned earlier, one will be weathered for one season, the other two will be weathered for a different season. So there'll be another combination of weathering for that. So the first thing that I need to do now that they're gloss coated, is do the chipping. Now there's lots of different ways I can do chipping. I can do hairspray method, which it's too late for me to do hairspray now. I could do just with a brush or a sponge, or a combination of brush and sponge, or I can do a combination of all three, which a lot of people like to do. I'm not a big fan of the hairspray method, not because there's anything wrong with it, I just don't like the look of it. with the exception of when it's done well by someone who really, really knows how to do it. Then, you know, I like looking at it then. But for most occasions, most of us are still trying to learn how to do it. So it's kind of uncontrolled and a bit messy looking most of the time, mine included. So the general look of it isn't so hot. So I'm not a fan of the hairspray method. But we all have to practice in order to get better at it. So, you know, it's expected to be seen in a messy format, I guess. So, but I don't want to get good at doing the hairspray method because I don't like the unpredictable nature of it. Yes, the chipping is supposed to be random and appear in an unpredictable fashion, but I don't like that level of uncontrolled effect when it comes to what I'm doing. And the hairspray method tends to have that. The level of texture that's achieved through the hairspray method, I with my eye, which isn't that great, I can't perceive an appreciable difference between painting the chips or using the hairspray method. So I don't bother with the extra step. So you won't see me use the hairspray method very often. Once in a while, I might do it here and there for one thing or the other. But it's a very rare thing that I'll ever use it. Most of the time, I use a sponge and a brush. So I have a favorite paint color that I use for doing chipping, for most things. Some things I don't really use it on. Depends on what it is I'm chipping. Now, American Armor. A lot of guys will get their knickers in a twist over American Armor. That it doesn't chip at all, which is horseshit. And same with German Armor. It's doesn't fade, which is also horseshit. That does fade, because I've seen plenty examples of 70-year-old German armor that was faded all to freaking shit and gone. So, yes, it does fade. It may not have been designed not to fade. It may have been designed not to fade, but it most certainly does over 70 years. I think probably even over 4 or 5 years it would probably fade. So, I think that's a giant load of horseshit. So, American Armor chips. You hit anything that's covered in paint hard enough, it's going to chip. Unless you find a way to dye steel, anything you cut with paint is going to chip if you hit it with something. Right? You're going to take a chunk out of the metal and poof, there's now a hole in the paint. Right? Yeah, it's going to come. It's going to have a hole. And in modeling, you're going to have to try and find a way to achieve that effect. It may look different on different kinds of metal, and how old that metal is, and how long that metal's been exposed to the elements and stuff like that, which is also something that modelers have to try and imitate. So, you know, studying which metals do what is a good idea, but just a blanket card answer saying that U.S. armor doesn't chip is, I'm sorry, that's erroneous. All right, there's a U.S. Sherman, about maybe 15 kilometers from here, and I've stood in front of it and looked right at it, and the thing's all chipped to hell and gone. And it's been like that for a long time. It's also faded to shit, too. So, it chips. It chips pretty good, too. So anyway, now, the primer that's used on American armor is the priming method is actually different than, say, German methods. So the way it chips is slightly different. Chipping is, I guess, less extreme because the paint would flake off in a slightly different way. But I don't really get caught up in a whole lot of that because I don't do a lot of chipping. I don't excessively chip my vehicle. I don't tend to make my vehicles look like they've been sitting in a farmer's field for 45 years when they're 3 months old. That's not something I really get into. When I weather my vehicles, I don't like that excessive weathered look. When I build my dioramas, I don't like that dry brushed, cherubic, Raphael-esque, Renaissance period look to my figures and my dioramas either. That's also a trend that floats around now and again. That's not saying it's bad, it's just personally I don't like the look of it, so I tend not to do it. Same thing with weathering. I won't excessively weather my vehicles. They're not going to be complete rust buckets covered in every imaginable color of rust spectrum you can imagine. It won't be that way. So, the first thing I'm going to do is chip, and then the next thing I'll do after that is hit it with a clay-based wash. Now, I do it in this method over the gloss paint for a very specific reason. Because if I don't like the way the chipping turns out, I can use Vallejo airbrush cleaner to remove the chips and either add them back in or leave them off altogether. So if I think I've screwed up the chipping, I can correct it very, very easily. So I use Vallejo's model colors right here. Vallejo model color 70822 German cam black brown. That's the color that I tend to use for chipping. For most things, just because it contrasts really well with most forms of paint. It looks a little bit like exposed metal that's oxidized slightly and turned that brownish color. And when you rub it with an HB pencil, it tends to take on an interesting luster that looks like slightly polished and maybe a tiny bit pitted metal. That tends to be achieved through casting. So that's why I use it. And that's it. No other explanation other than that. I think that's it. Yeah. Anyway, so I'm going to get out my tools and then get started. Okay, so now for chipping, it's pretty much the same for all the vehicles and all the things that I'm doing. So I don't need to vary what it is I'm doing very much. Move this a little closer. Hopefully you guys can hear me. I've moved the microphone into a different place so that when I'm doing work and banging on this thing, the microphone's not losing its shit, because it tends to. Got this fancy new microphone, a blue sphere, I don't know what the fuck it's called, and it tends to be a bit sensitive to thumping. So anyway, I think I'm going to do the turret of the 105. Actually, no. I'm going to do the hull of the 105 for the first thing of chipping. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take... This is a piece of green scrubby sponge. Some of this green scouring pad, plastic scouring pad. I take this and I pull it apart, tease it apart, and cut it into a small piece like this. And I put it in my squeezers and I hold it like that and I dip it in paint. And that gives me a varied and unusual texture type for doing chips. I also have my, I don't know where my other one is. This one's for doing very large areas, but it's a magnified version of it, I guess. It's basically just a piece of stick with some popsicle sticks and a sponge glued onto the end. And I use this, so basically I dip it in paint and stamp it on the surface. I can also drag and turn it and use the corners and stuff to do all kinds of different textures and shapes for doing chips and stuff like that. I have a small one around here somewhere, but I'll be damned if I know where it is. Oh, there it is. I don't know why it's way up there. But there's the little one there. This is the little one that I use. I use this one quite often too. And then there's the handy dandy paintbrush. This is just some piece of shit from some wargaming thing. It's not a very good one, but it'll do. And then I have my paint, and I have a little bit of thinner. So, give the paint a bit of shake. All I only use a little bit of paint at a time. Because it dries pretty quick. And I don't do that wet palette business thing. I can't be arsed to do it. If you want to do that, go ahead. I'm not going to stop you. I'm not going to criticize you. I just don't honestly give a shit. the fact of the matter is I don't give a crap. So you'll probably find that there's a great deal of things that people do in the modeling world that I don't give a crap about. And I just don't do it because, personally, I think it's stupid. And I just see it as a waste of time. But I keep that to myself most of the time. Most of the time. Right. So, I'm going to do a little bit of chipping around the hatch area here. And I'm going to do it first with this scrubby thing. So I dip it in the paint and then dab it off so that there's less on it. I don't want too much on there because there'll be too much material. And I only want to do it a little tiny bit. When it comes to chips, less is more. Thing. Then I do the majority of it with the brush. Make sure that I can see everything. Mostly just boring work. But now, there is multicolor and single color chipping. This is single color chipping, where I'm just using a single color to achieve the chipping effect. I can use a multiple color, where I take the assumed undercolor, like the primer color, and I chip with that first, and then for all the chips that I did with that, I go back over it and use this color to darken in the centers of it. That's two-stage chipping. You can even go further and you can use a lighter version of the top color. So I take this olive green color, and then I would lighten it slightly, chip with that, and then I would put inside of those chips, inside each of those larger chips, I would add a darker color, which would represent the primer, and then inside of that, I would add a third color, like this dark brown, which would represent the deeper chips, which actually went all the way down to the middle. That would be like quite intense chipping, and it would take you a very long time to do it, for one. But it looks pretty good as long as you don't overdo it. It's very easy to overdo it because once you start doing it, the effect becomes addictive and it's hard to stop it, and then you can overchip your vehicle very quickly. When it comes to chipping, less is more, and it doesn't take long to get more. You only need a little bit. You go too far, you go too heavy, and your vehicle looks like it's been sitting in a farmer's field since 1945, and it's now 1982, and it's ready for the scrapyard. So you want to try to avoid that if you can, unless that's what you're trying to do. I usually try to avoid it as much as possible, which is why I usually stick to the single color of chipping, because it helps keep me from going overboard. Now, there's tiny little dots you can add, very tiny little dots, very, very, very tiny little scratches, and then groups of unusual shapes, like patches, like little jagged patches and stuff. These are the types of shapes of chips that you can add. The trick is to add as many of the of those in a variety. Don't just make it all a bunch of dots. And don't make it all a bunch of scratches. And don't make it all a bunch of patches. Because if you do that, it doesn't look realistic. And don't make them huge. Oh my goodness, don't make them enormous. If you make them enormous, I mean, yeah, then they just look enormous. It looks like you chipped it with a dishcloth or something, it's too hot and too heavy. It's just too much. So keep your chips small. Keep them random as much as you can. Keep them irregular shaped. And don't go crazy with them. Not every single surface has to have chips on it. Not every single surface needs to be beaten all to shit. It's not necessary. Most of them, you're not probably going to see a lot of them anyway. You're only going to see some of them. So don't worry about them too much. Right now I'm covering up one of my mistakes. I'll tell you what it is. There's a bad habit that a lot of modelers have, and that's blowing on your model to blow stuff away. When you do that, you're spitting on your model too. I don't know if you can see it. I'm going to use this camera here. You see it on this fender here. See those spots? That's spit. That's my spit that's reacted to the gloss. There's more on the transmission cover. I can get it there. Right there. That's what happens when you blow on your model. All right. It's something you should really try and avoid doing, because, well, that's what happens. Right now I'm covering it up by hiding them with chips, trying to break up the pattern. Spittleflage, I guess. I'll cover it even further with dirt later. One of the things that receives a lot of wear and tear are corners and raised edges. So anywhere there's a corner tends to get a lot of rubbing and abrasion through chipping. So having random chips and pieces and chunks missing along a raised edge, like this edge along this fender, is a good idea. But you got to remember, there's more than one edge. There's the top edge that I'm doing here, then there's the one under it. So there's, you got to do underneath too. So that's why when you're doing the top one, like I'm doing now, try not to go crazy with the chips, because if you do, you end up doing too many, because you've probably forgotten about the bottom. Then you end up with too many, and it looks kind of stupid. Just remember, I'm putting this over a gloss surface that's made out of Alclad Aqua Gloss, and I chose that material very specifically because if I make mistakes with the chips with the Alclad Aqua Gloss, I can very easily removed the chips that I put on after the aqua gloss, because the Vallejo airbrush cleaner, which is useless for cleaning airbrushes, but it's very, very useful for removing chips from paint. So if I've over-chipped my vehicle, I can use the aqua gloss or the Vallejo airbrush cleaner to remove the chips. I believe that's in that Fact magazine, Fact book. Okay, so basically what you just saw me there is what I'm going to be doing to all three vehicles, all the way around. I'm not going to be doing anything different. Mostly I'll be doing it with the brush. I might do a little bit more with the sponges, depending on my mood, but probably not. Most likely I'll be doing it most of it with the brush. Just got to clean it. I have to clean the brush every now and again because the paint starts to get too thick. So I have to clean off the excess. And now if I use a wet palette, it reduces that problem. But again, I can't be urged to do something like that. It's more complicated. It's just easier for me to clean the brush every couple of minutes. So anyway, I'm going to keep going with this, and then I'll come back once all the chipping is done, and I'll show you how the Vallejo airbrush cleaner removes chips, and then I will get on with the washes. Okay, so I'm going to show you how I use the Vallejo airbrush cleaner to remove chips that I don't want. I've got a bunch on this Pershing tank that I don't need. I got some airbrush cleaner here. I'm going to grab a cotton bud, get it a little bit damp with the airbrush cleaner. Now that chip there is one I don't want on there. I just dab it on. And I dry it off. And that's it. And there. I don't completely remove it. Basically what I do is I break it apart so there's less of it. There's some here I don't like. And the only reason I'm able to do this is because of the Vallejo airbrush cleaner, or the aqua gloss is so tough it can put up with this. I mean, it's not indestructible. If I rub too hard, it will start taking it apart. But it gives me enough time that I can mess with it before it does. And that's all I need. It's just a little bit of a gap. Just enough. That one's too big. There. That's pretty much it. So it's pretty simple. It's not that complicated. It's a nice, easy way to fix your chips if you go overboard with them. Makes it a lot easier. You don't have to worry about it. And the aqua gloss gives you a lot of saving grace. So, yay for that, I guess. Anyway, that's all I got for that. Next, I'm going to set up to do the wash. It's going to be a clay-based wash, a sludge wash that I put all over the entire vehicle. Wait about a couple of minutes. Actually, what I'm going to do is cheat and use a hairdryer. And then I'll take it all off in a pattern. And then dry it again with a hairdryer. And then I'll seal it with a dull coat from Windsor Newton Galleria. So I'll be back in a sec. Okay, so everything's all set up, and all I have to do is start working. All right, so this is my wash here. It's a clay wash that I make myself. It's just a raw umber colored clay wash made from chalk pastels that I buy online from Amazon. I buy a couple of sets of these really cheap pastel stick sets, and then I crush them up in a mortar and pestle until they're like a fine dust. And then I throw the dust in here, mix this with some water, some glycerol, a few drops of alcohol, and that's it. Really, that's all I do. And then whenever I need it, I just pull this thing out and give it a good shake. Wow, there's somebody on Tundra there. and then I apply it using a nice long-haired bristled brush like this. All right, that's not too thick, but now it's got a fairly narrow thing on it. And I do a sludge wash with it. Now I'm going to do a sludge wash to one of the turrets, because it's the easiest thing for me to hold in front of the camera. Now I'm running two cameras for this video series, and so it's going to take a hell of a lot for me to edit this whole thing together, but I'm hoping I can mesh all this together. So I got two cameras running. I got this one here. This is my web camera. And then I have this one here. It's my Sony Handycam. So I'm doing that in order for me to be able to find the best way to demonstrate what it is I'm doing here. So this is a new thing for me. All right. So I take the wash, hold the turret, make sure that everybody can see it, and just pick some wash up with the brush, and I sludge it on. I'm basically pushing it into the cracks and nooks and crannies and near where the base is of all the raised and lowered detail or recessed detail. And I don't want to make pools of the stuff. But I want to coat everything, so that everything has the same level of pigmentation. Now this turret that I'm putting this on is heavily textured with cast texturing, so I want to make sure I get this thing well covered. That doesn't mean completely and totally soaked with the stuff so that it's like, you know, 3 millimeters deep or anything. But I want to make sure that every surface has had wash brushed onto it, and that I haven't missed anything. Because once it dries, you'll notice it. You may not notice it when you're applying it, because it's well, I don't make it really, really, really thick. So, and one of the things that's cool about this is I can add it in layers. If I don't think it's thick enough the first time, I can go back and add it again. Now for the top surfaces like this, I tend to just brush it on, I rub it in like I'm doing now. But when it comes to vertical surfaces, like the sides and stuff like that, I tend to do it in bands, in streaks, so that it reflects the motion of water and weathering, and rather than dirt accumulation into flat surfaces. And I use that because when I go to take it off, I try to maintain some of the dirt that's left behind. So that there's a little bit of streaking effect happening. All right, so that's the top of that, the turret, near the top of the mantlet. Now what I'm doing here, you've seen me do before, using clay washes before. I've done a how-to video on how I use clay washes. But there's more to it than what I've been doing before. Now when you do this with clay washes, it vastly speeds up your build time. You go from waiting days for something to dry to waiting a few minutes for something to dry, because these clay washes dry in minutes. Okay, now I'm going to be doing the sides, and like I said, I try to do it in streaks heading downward, and I'll maintain this effect when I remove it. When I remove it with a cotton bud, I take it off the same way so that it maintains the effect. Now you can add darker colors to this wash, so you can mix like this is a raw umber color, which is like a dark brown, but you can use a burnt umber, which is kind of it's also a dark brown, but it's got more of a reddish tone to it, but it's also a slightly darker tone in a way. And I find that it looks a bit like rust when you use the burnt umber. So if you really want your vehicle to look battered and old, mix the two of them together, or just use the burnt umber alone, can help make your vehicle look quite old. The other thing you can do is, instead of using a raw umber or burnt umber, you can use black, mix them with black to add a really dark wash, and it'll make your vehicle look quite stark in its contrast. So it won't really make it look old or young or anything like that. What it'll do is really highlight the detail. It'll like a lot, almost like a comic book type effect if you go too dark. Which is why I use browns rather than blacks. If I use black, it tends to be a little bit overdone. Okay, so let's turret done. Okay, set this down. Clean up for your brush is as easy as you can imagine. Brush, water, pot, squirt, rub, wipe, done. Cleaned up. Now, next thing, hair dryer. This will very greatly speed up the drying process. Not too close, though. You'll push your wash around if you're too close. There. Done. Now, the next thing I want to do is remove the wash. So I need more water. That'll do. Cotton buds. These are just cheapo over-the-counter cotton buds from the grocery store. Now, I don't want to take them and soak them. I want to dampen them so that they're just moist. And then I clean off all the open areas and leave the nooks and crannies alone. Now, your effect, you vary it by cleaning off more or leaving on wash. So the more you clean it up, the less dirty it looks, and the more you leave behind, the more dirty it looks. And it's entirely up to you how much you want to do. And one of the great things about the clay-based wash, if you screw it up, go take it into the bathroom, run it under the sink and the tap for a couple of seconds, and with a cotton bud there, and it'll wash all the what you did off, and try again. It's very, very forgiving, which is one of the reasons why I like it so much, because I make so many mistakes. I'm making the vertical marks. Rain marks as much as I can. Now, if some of your cotton bud gets torn apart and stuck in the detail like that, don't worry about that. When you put the flat varnish on later, all that stuff will stick out like a sore thumb, and you can see it very easily. And you just go in with a pair of tweezers and pull them off. Very easy to remove. You can pull them off now if you want. But you want to make sure you get them all. Wait till after you've sprayed the matte varnish on, because you'll see them then. They stick out like sore thumbs once the varnish is on. So if you've got shitty eyes like I do, you won't miss any. Alright, so that's pretty much done that. So that's pretty much how you do the wash. So I can wait about maybe 10 minutes for that to dry. Once that's dry, I will spray it with the matte coat. I'm not going to do it now because I wanted to actually do the rest of the tanks. So I'm going to do that, and then I'll come back and then show you the end result before I do the matte coat, and then I'll do the matte coat and then show you what it looks like once the matte coat is dried. Alright, fellas, so this is what three vehicles look like with the wash taken off. It's all there, have all been washed with the clay wash, and then it's all been taken off. And I finished doing the tie downs for the stowage. You can see there. Looks all right, I guess. So the next thing is to seal it all with a varnish to protect the clay-based wash. I would do the same thing if I had done it with an oil. The only difference between using a clay-based wash or an oil-based wash to do the impressed or raised detail highlighting is one dries faster than the other. The color and the texture is relatively the same thing. They're almost the same in appearance. So for this stage, I generally prefer to use the clay, but there are some subjects where I prefer to use the oil. If the surface texture of the vehicle I'm doing is very, very smooth, I tend to use an oil rather than the clay. If it's very coarse and porous and I want the vehicle to look really dirty, then I'll go with the clay. The clay tends to be larger pigments and tends to give a darker, more dirtier look. So it's not a one is better than the other. It's more, one is more suited for some things than another type of choice. So, but for what I want to do here, I want the vehicles to look relatively grungy. Lots of service, and so lots of texture and character. So now I'm going to seal it with a varnish, and I'm going to use this Galleria matte varnish from Winsor & Newton. Now, I've been using this stuff for a couple of months now, I guess. 3 or 4 months, I think. 3 months. In replacement of, dig it out now. This here is Tester's dull coat in the small glass bottle. You mix this 50-50 with just plain lacquer thinner that you can get at a local hardware store. Now this bottle makes a little bit more than what comes in this. This you don't have to mix with anything. Right? You just basically just put it in your airbrush and spray it. Between 17 and 20 psi. It's a bit thick. You don't have to shake it up much. Gentle shake, right? Don't agitate it. Just, you know, just so you disturb the contents, right? Do that for like a minute. But don't shake it so that there's foam. Don't do that. Just, you know, just so that there's nothing stuck on the bottom, right? Is basically what you want to do. So in the so once you mix this 50-50 with lacquer thinner, what you're left is that's not it, is a bottle about this big. So it makes about that much full, right? So it's a bottle about this big full, and it doesn't go as far as this. Now, two bottles of this cost about the same as one bottle of this, but two bottles of this make more than this. However, and this is the important part, this sprays thinner, so you have to spray more on your subject than you do with this. So this covers better, so you use less. So this goes further than the dull coat. So you end up using more of the dull coat faster than you do of this. So this ends up being a better price ratio kind of expenditure, blah, blah, blah. Because you use less of it to do more. Even though the price difference between these two, for me anyway, is only a few dollars. So now for me, these are very expensive things to buy. Now, I have just recently found a very cheap place, well, comparatively cheap for a place to buy this. Now, in the UK and in Europe, this is like $10 Canadian, $11 Canadian, plus maybe $3, $5 shipping. Here in Canada, it's about $40. but if I get it at Winsor & Newton's actual website and order it on their, they have a U.S.-Canadian website. If I order it from them, it's a little bit cheaper, but only a little bit. It's around maybe $30 to buy it from them. I haven't found a place in Canada that sells this for less than $30. Not yet, anyway. I'm still looking. But I have friends in the UK that can just go to their local art store and buy this for £8 and then ship it to me for another, I don't know, £8 total, probably, £8 or £10. And it ends up being still, that's actually cheaper to get it from the UK. So, yeah, anyway, but this ends up being cheaper in the long run than this. And then there's the best benefit. This is a lacquer, this is an acrylic. So this is always better. I don't like lacquers because they stink like hell. And in the long run, they'll kill me. So even when I'm using my exhaust hood and Darth Vader mask, I'm still not a big fan of using heavy solvents and stuff like that when it comes to spraying paint. So I avoid it when I can. So the reason why I use this now is to try and avoid using the lacquer-based matte coat. So now I will one day probably just use up the last of the dull coat just to get rid of it, and so it stops taking up room on my shelf. But for at least now anyway, I'm still getting used to using this, so I'm using this for now. The other more specific modeling type matte coats, like AKs, Ultra Matte, and stuff like that, I've tried them, and I don't like them. I find them too delicate, or the final finish of them isn't good enough. They're nowhere near as good as the dull coat, and they're nowhere near as good as this stuff. The final finish is just not the same. So this is far superior, at least for what I need it to be, this is far superior. So anyway, that's enough about that. So this is what I'm going to use to flat coat these, and so I'll do that up. I'll spray them, and then I'll show you what they look like. But first, before I do that, I'll show you what they look like now. Which one am I going to pick? I'm going to pick, I guess, the Easy 8. So this is what the Easy 8 looks like now with the, just gloss coat with the clay wash on it. You can see how it has a dirty look to it. It's still shiny from the gloss coat, but it has a dirty look to it. And all of the raised and recessed details are now accentuated. And there's a slight amount of streaking and banding from where I took it off in streaks. Yeah, using the cotton bud when I was taking it off, I used it basically dragging it in downward motions to give a slight rain weathering type of effect. At least I hope so, anyway. And now there's certain bits that I avoided putting any wash on. I've tried to avoid putting it on the air recognition flag and the ration box because I didn't want any wash on there. I wanted it to be fairly clean. So that's about it, I guess. So anyway, so I'm going to spray this on. Don't need to see me spraying a varnish. That's kind of redundant. Basically, if you want to know what I do, I put it in my airbrush and then turn my airbrush on, my compressor on, and then I spray it. And then I clean my airbrush up, and then I wait about 4 hours for it to harden up enough for me to work on. I usually wait 12 hours for this stuff. With dull coat, I can work on it in 20 minutes because it dries so fast. With this, it takes about a day for it to harden up enough that you can work on it, where it's not, doesn't feel sticky to the touch. Dull coat is 20 minutes. You can work on it almost right away. The stuff dries almost immediately. So, but anyway, so I'll get that done and then I'll come back. Okay, so I just finished spraying the first hull. And so this one here has been sprayed with matte coat. It's still settling, so there's still the tiniest bit of shine to it, Once it's completely dry, the shine completely disappears. So one thing you're going to notice, if you're using the clays for your initial wash for your detailing, when you spray it with the matte coat, the wash, the clay wash, will darken considerably. And that's what you want. So make sure, well, I don't know if it's what you want, but you should plan for it, at least when you're using it. You should expect it to darken. So, and your chips also, your dark brown chips will suddenly become very, very visible. Now, this one has not been sprayed. This is still in its gloss coat. And if you notice, where's the camera? There it is. On this one here, the chips aren't exactly really, really easy to see. There's a lot of shine that hides them, and the tones hide it. But on this one, the dull coat really brings it out. You can see the chips a lot more than you could before. And the wash is a lot darker, and the tank looks considerably more dirty and faded than it was before. So that's a lot of the effects that the varnish will do. And that's what you're going for. That's what you want. Well, at least it's what I want. I should probably say that. It's what I want. It may not be what you want, because you may want different things. But, so the effect that I'm chasing after is exactly that. I want a somewhat faded look to the paint, and I want the wash to pop out in all the details that I sunk it into, and I want the chips to show up more. If I leave it in a shine, those things kind of disappear. Now, there is a need for shine on certain vehicles. This isn't an always case, but sometimes for parade vehicles and stuff like that, they tend to have a bit of a shine for them. They clean them up, and sometimes there's a shine on them. I've seen a lot of vehicles in parade, on parade and stuff like that, where there's a bit of shine. Or vehicles that are, there's like not an active theater going on, so the vehicles tend to not have that dull sort of sheen to their paint. There tends to be a bit of a gloss to it. I'm suspecting it's mostly to help retard weathering from rain. The rain rolls off of it better rather than sticks to the paint, and it slows down rusting. I'm guessing at that. I really don't know what the reasoning is. Or maybe the military actually likes the shiny tanks. I don't know. I don't honestly know why they do it. I have seen it done, but I don't know the explanation for it. Right? I can think of a few explanations, and all of them are somewhat reasonable, I guess. So, but either way, that's beside the point. The point I'm trying to make is when you're doing your varnishes, when you apply the varnish, there is a significant difference in the two textures, and the biggest one is your washes will darken and your chips will suddenly become revealed. So that highlights the importance of using the really good gloss coat with the Vallejo airbrush cleaner for removing the chips, because you want to pay close attention to where those chips are, because if you forget any, once you do this and put your varnish on, you're never going to get the chips off. So it's very, very much too late. So anyway, I'm going to get back to putting the rest of the varnish on. So that's a difference that a wash, or that a dull coat makes, or a matte coat, or a flat coat, whatever it is you want to call it. Any of those terms would work. One of the things that putting a matte coat or flat coat on a model does is it eliminates luster. And when you hide the luster, it makes it easier to see a lot of the detail that the luster was hiding. Your eye can get distracted by a lot of the shine. So when you hit it with the matte coat, you're going to see a lot of the detail that was hidden before. It can also change the tone of the paint. It can darken it. When you put the, or lighten it when you put the matte coat on. Just conversely, when you put a gloss coat on something, it tends to darken it quite a bit. So matte coat will lighten it, and the dark coat or gloss coat will darken it. Interesting things to keep in mind when you're working, if you want to make adjustments to things. So anyway,
Now, one of the things that is interesting at this point anyway, is now is about the time when I would usually consider doing a little bit of highlighting. I'd either do it now or after I do filters. And this is also the point where I decide what filters I'm going to be using, if I'm going to use any. If I'm going to use any filters or dot filters or glazes or mapping, is what they used to be called. The overall filter used to be called a glaze, and the dot filter used to be called mapping. I still tend to call them that because that's what I learned what they were called when I first learned how to do them. So I accidentally still call them that sometimes, so if you hear me calling them that, it's not intentional. I don't mean to be confusing. I don't know why they changed the name, probably for marketing purposes. Some jackass decided he wanted to come out with a new product that was actually already in existence, but gave it a new name to make everyone think it was a new product. There tends to be a lot of jackasses out there that do that kind of thing. They like to take advantage of our ignorance, and they do it quite a lot, so you should probably be aware of that. But it's hard to know the history of all the modeling products that are out there, so it's easy to be accidentally taken advantage of. But it always sucks when you found that you've been taken for a ride by some schmuck. So anyway, so one of the things that I like to do either at this point or a little bit later is called dry brushing. Now, dry brushing is pretty simple thing if you don't know what it is. Basically, take a wide flat brush, something like this. It doesn't have to be as wide as this. It can be much narrower than this, depending on the thing that you're working on. And you, I tend to use brushes that have a bit of an angle to it, like this one does. I don't like the flat ones, like this one. This one is like directly flat across the tip of the bristles. I don't much like those. I like the ones that have a bit of a shape on the end, like a rounded end. Mostly because it gives a bit of a varied appearance when I'm applying dry brushing, especially on flat surfaces. And that's mostly what I like to use it on. But it also helps me get into like nooks and crannies and stuff like that without having to change a brush. So, but anyway, this is like actually one of my favorite weathering brushes for doing dry brushing. So dry brushing, I do it on materials such as denim, leather, canvas, cloth, anything like that, soft stuff. I use it to highlight the detail on it. And I try to follow the principle as closely as possible of less is more. When it comes to dry brushing, it's really important. It's very easy to go overboard with the highlighting on a model and kind of make it look a lot like a Raphael cherubic Renaissance period painting. It happens a lot with figures, I've seen it a lot in some dioramas. It's actually a style. It's not a mistake. It's a style. I guess it's a point of view thing. Some people would see it as a mistake. Me being one of them. Because I don't like the look. It's not because it's wrong. It's because I don't like it, so I would see it as a mistake. Well, that doesn't mean it is. I'm well aware of the fact of how much of an arrogant, postulating, pontificating asshole I am. So I tend to do things like that, but I try to keep it in my head. Other people have trouble with that, and it tends to come out too much. But anyway, so one of the things that I do is the dry brushing. And dry brushing is a simple thing. You basically take your brush, and you pick up some paint with it, and then you rub it on like a piece of paper towel, and you keep rubbing it back and forth and back and forth and back and forth until there's almost no paint at all on your bristles. And then you very, very gently brush it onto the parts that you want to brush, bringing out just the high points. And you start very, very light. You very, very, very subtle. And you gently bring it up to the point that you want it to. So start small. Start very little paint, gently building it up. Don't start with a little tiny bit of paint and then put it on and then add more paint to your brush and brush off less. Don't do that. Do the same. So pick up some paint, the same amount of paint, brush it all off, add it. Pick up the same amount of paint, brush the same amount off, and add it. Don't get bigger and bigger with your paint amount on your brush. J- just add more and more layers. So eventually you'll get it to a point where you think it's okay and it's not too much, and leave it at that. So how I do it is I will start on one piece, like let's say this roll here, like this sleeping bag here, and I'll dry brush this. I don't actually have any paint on this. So I'll dry brush this and bring up the detail, and I'll get it to the point that I want it to. And I'll use that as a guide for the rest. I will try to get all of the rest of the stowage to be at the same level of dry brushed that that's at. That way it's all the same, and it's not overdone, and it's not underdone. And I do that all the way around the vehicle. So I use one as like a legend, right? And then do that. I will also dry brush the vehicle itself, but I won't do that until almost the very end. Before I do pigments is when I dry brush it. And it's usually I'll take either a lighter color of the original paint, or I will take a buff color and do it, or I'll take a color that matches the groundwork and dry brush certain areas. So what I'll do is depending on the scene, if it's a really dirty tank, I'll take colors that match the groundwork, and I'll dry brush areas around where the crew comes in and out. And then after that's dry, I'll come back with a lighter color, like a buff color, and then I will dry brush everything else. So the two colors are working together. One is being a dirt effect, like a weathering effect, and the other one is a lighting effect. So the two of them are working together. I'll do both those things. I'm not a fan of doing that overspray dusting effect, where you take like a buff color and put it in your airbrush and just mist it on. I've never been a fan of doing that because it's difficult to control and it tends to be too homogeneous. It's too uniform. I've never liked the look of that. And you can't mess with it after it's been applied. So I tend to do it with pigments instead. I'll take a large brush like this and add, I'll take pigments and put it in a little tiny pot and pick it up with a brush and then do it. And I'll use the brush to add the pigments. Now, I don't tend to handle my models after I've finished them. So handling them and rubbing off the subtle details and stuff isn't really a problem. But I will, at the very end, after construction, I'll mist coat some flat varnish onto it to make sure that, you know, there's enough on there to fix it in. Usually about 20 centimeters I'll spray, but I guess that's about 20 centimeters. That's about 18 or 20, I guess. I don't really know. Something like that. But like that. About that distance. Let me see. Yeah, about that distance from the model. I'll spray like a matte varnish on, just to seal everything in. Not far enough away that it will fog the model, and not too close that it will wash off the or obliterate the pigment work I've done. So like a happy medium. And I found about 20 centimeters and very low pressure is usually is where it works. I end up avoiding the fog, and I don't wash off the pigments. Anyway, so that's later on. I'm getting ahead of myself. That's much later on. So right about now, or after I've done the filters and dot filters, is when I do the dry brushing. For this, I'm going to do it after I do the filters. I don't think that these need much in the way of filtering, but I'm going to let the paint or the matte coat dry for a few hours and then think about it. I have to take into account the age of the vehicles. Because with the filter, that's one of the things I use to age the paint. So these two vehicles would be about roughly the same age. The Pershing would be slightly newer. Get it in a shot. The Pershing would be a slightly newer tank, but not by much. Right? They'd be roughly about the same age. They've been in the battlefield for about roughly the same amount of time. So exposure to the sun would be about roughly about the same amount of time. So the paint on these three vehicles really wouldn't have suffered a whole lot in the way of fading. So I don't need a lot in the way of filters. Now, for me, I use filters to fade paint, or I use it to correct mistakes I've made in camouflage by blending or adding a varnish that binds the three or four colors of camouflage together. That's what I use a filter for. I don't automatically always add a filter. I think it's an enormous mistake to just think you always need to add a filter no matter what. I don't think that's a correct way of thinking. Dot filtering, however, or mapping, I think is something that is a very important part. Dot filtering is when you take small dots of oil paint and put them onto the vehicle, and then you drag a thinner dampened brush through it in order to provide tonal variety to large flat areas of vehicles. That's a very important character adding element, which I'm going to demonstrate soon. So now, because I have to wait for a number of hours for this varnish to dry, I'm going to basically say this is the end of this part of the video, and the next part will cover the beginnings of oil work, and then after that will be dry brushing, and then finally the end will be pigments and if there's any mud work, and then at the very end will be environmental. So if it's a spring and summer scene, it'll mostly be just dust. If it's a winter scene, it'll be a little bit of dust, but mostly maybe frost effects like snow and stuff like that. So, but that's at the very end. So anyway, so I'm going to call it the end of this part, and I'll probably come back with the next video, maybe in a few days, depending on how long it takes. It takes a while to film these and edit them, so because they're all filmed in chunks, and I'm using the second camera, so it takes a while for me to edit the damn things. So anyway, that's all I got for this one. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now.